These words are a gift from my colleague and dear friend, the Reverend Lois Van Leer. Who knows what anxieties, what fears, what panic any of us may bring to this time and space this morning? Who knows what snippets of contentment, calm, and peace any of us may bring to this time and space this morning? Perhaps you are lonely. Perhaps you long to be alone. Perhaps you are feeling trapped in your shelter. Perhaps you long to be sheltered in with others. Maybe this time, unlike anything we may have experienced, looms large and long before us. Maybe this time feels empty and we are at a loss on how to fill it. Maybe this time is a blessed relief, holding within untapped possibility, a return to something simple, a reduction in our human footprint, a time of the community of relationships and community. Whatever you bring to this time and place this morning, I invite you to set it down, to expect nothing. Open to receive whatever might be taking from our worship something, some peace that will nurture you through the coming days. Wherever you are, may you find some comfort here and now. I invite you to join in singing Wo Ya Ya. Our reading today comes from Life Changing, A Philosophical Guide by Dr. Timothy Rainer. Since Richard Dean Anderson played MacGyver in the eponymous TV series, originally screening on ABC television between 1985 and 1992, MacGyver has become synonymous with seat of your pants, do-it-yourself innovation. In each episode of the show, MacGyver gets caught in at least one life-threatening situation, only to escape it Houdini-like by applying his knowledge and cobbling together an improbable solution using whatever happens to be lying around. MacGyver's indefatigable knowledge and resourcefulness became a running gag on the show. As the episodes rolled by, MacGyver revealed extraordinary insights into medicine, engineering, chemistry, physics, and a host of other disciplines beyond the ken of your average secret agent. The show's writers would drop MacGyver into increasingly desperate situations, only to have him invent ever more outlandish ways to escape them. MacGyver treated every situation with his trademark cool. While other people panicked and despaired, MacGyver would cobble together a parachute, a rocket launcher, some plastic explosive, or a jerry-rigged jet ski that would enable him to avert the crisis and save the day. Most of the time, it was ludicrous. Still, audiences loved it. Such was the success of the show that one still hears talk of people MacGyvering their way out of difficult situations today. MacGyver is a hero for our times. MacGyver is never stumped by a situation. He confronts each new challenge head on and reveals it as an opportunity to apply his knowledge and skills. MacGyver doesn't worry about what is out of his hands. He's too stoic for that. He focuses on his resources and what he can do with them. Drawing on his full range of powers and applying them in creative ways, MacGyver transforms crises into moments of glory. He flourishes in contexts of change. Calamitous situations bring out the best in him. Given the regularity with which MacGyver finds himself in peril, one can only assume he pursues these situations to put himself to the test. With resilience, agility, and vision, it is possible to MacGyver change by revealing new opportunities in unexpected situations. Next time you find yourself in a difficult situation without any idea how to proceed, ask, what would MacGyver do? MacGyver would get a grip on himself, tap into his powers, and project a solution that transformed everything. MacGyver would rethink the situation and turn the moment of change into a life-changing moment of vision. We're going to sing together, When I Am Frightened.
When I am frightened, assure me. When I'm uncertain, will you hold my hand? Will you be strong for me? Sing to me quietly. Will you share some of your stories with me? If
If you are not a child of the 80s, you may not have watched the television show MacGyver. As for me, I don't think I missed a single episode. It may have helped that I had a little crush on Richard Dean Anderson, mullet and all. And what would happen on the show week after week is he'd get in a jam and he would just look around, identify random objects that could be repurposed, and then he'd open his backpack where he usually carried duct tape and a Swiss Army knife, and he would just jury rig his way out. And his solution was always brilliant, but it was never pretty. Now, lest you think that this is just a Gen X pop culture reference, to MacGyver is now a verb, an actual one in the dictionary, and it means to make or repair something in an improvised or inventive way, making use of whatever items are at hand. For example, he MacGyvered a makeshift jack with a log, and that is from the Oxford English Dictionary. So here we are in these times where we find ourselves in many a jam, from toilet paper shortages to trying to cram work and homeschooling into 2 short days, navigating stores where no one else is wearing a mask. Some of us are dealing with job loss. And then there are the big things. Our democracy is not working the way it's supposed to. It's broken. Some days I'm afraid that we're sliding toward totalitarianism. And we're losing a lot. We've lost our routine. We've lost our sense of predictability and safety. All of our accustomed ways of doing things are not accessible to us. And so it's no wonder that some days it feels like our lives are falling apart. We really are trying to navigate unfamiliar territory, and we're leaving trails of broken bits and pieces in our wake. But here's the thing, and this is a faith statement. We have everything we need to survive. Not only that, but we have everything we need to thrive. I think we've proven in the last month or two that we have the capacity to completely reconfigure church. So there's that. And businesses are reconfiguring too. I went to into a downtown store in Moscow, Ampersand. I don't know if you've ever gone there. And I was talking to the business owner, and she said she just had to retool everything, but she was able to do it and she's doing okay. And this is what I've been hearing as I go and I check in with the business owners, the small business owners of the businesses that I have a vested interest in keeping open to check in and see how they're doing, is that they're figuring it out. We have this capacity to reconfigure our way of life. Now, the screenwriter for MacGyver has actually written a book, and his contention is that we all have an inner MacGyver, and that MacGyver, that inner MacGyver, lives at the intersection of our knowledge, our intellect, our experience, and our intuition. That's where the location of genius is. So he suggests a simple three-part process to harness our inner MacGyver. The first is to spend some time writing down the question or the problem. And to do that as clearly and specifically as possible. And then he says, leave it. Leave the question and go do something else so that your subconscious can play in. He talks about driving or taking showers. But then lifts up the fact that really anything that doesn't require focus will allow us to tap into that inner MacGyver. So repetitive tasks are good. Watching TV or reading books or playing video games, not so much because those distract us, but repetitive tasks are really useful. I've been weeding and weeding and weeding. And then you come back after spending this time doing something else unrelated and kind of mindless, and you start writing again, and you just let the answer flow. Now, I think when we apply this to our lives, to our path of personal growth, the first step is just to look around and be honest about what we see and what we feel. We have to embrace reality and not hide from the parts of it that we don't like. And then we also have to see it as dispassionately as possible. MacGyver never got worked up in these dangerous situations, and we need to do what we need to do so that we don't get worked up either. And that means breathing through our emotional reactions, doing all of the self-care and self-soothing activities that help us come back to our best selves so that we can live from our higher intellect, from our prefrontal cortex, and not from our amygdala. I talk about that a lot. We also have to be open to new perspectives. One of the things that MacGyver was particularly good at was separating things from their usual context. And when you do that, sometimes a new purpose is revealed. I'm thinking of the folks who are planting potatoes in buckets. Apparently, buckets make really good potato pots. Or I was watching a video of Jimmy Kimmel and the Roots. And there was a guy who plays percussion, and he was playing a toaster. Who knew that a toaster makes a really good percussion instrument? It's also important in this first step of embracing reality to say what is true. Vulnerability is a sign of strength, not weakness. And you know, there's a way in which when we say, "Oh, everything's okay, everything's okay," we keep ourselves from actually figuring out how to make things really okay. I hope that makes sense. So the second step, which in the screenwriter's framework is about going and doing something else, I think it's important to use that time to get really clear about what we need to survive. We need to remember that what we're used to is not equal to what we actually need. I don't think there's ever been a better time to reflect on questions like, what can we let go of? And then what can't we let go of? We let the creative, resilient spirit inside us do that magic work. That could be through meditation or journaling or yoga, nature therapy, going for a walk, as Ginger said, is always good. Those simple, repetitive actions. Remember the sermon that I did on resilience and about how we evolved so that simple, repetitive actions, people who are soothed by those things are more resilient in life. So knitting or again, the weeding or whatever it is that works for you. We need to quiet that monkey mind, the thoughts that get us spun up, and stop distracting ourselves. Although I will say, I think a little bit of distraction is okay. You know, if you're having a hard time and you need to binge watch a TV show for a little while and check out, you have my permission, not that you need my permission. But also make space in your life to just be, and let the subconscious take the reins. And then that third step is you cobble something together. And remember, it doesn't have to be pretty. Our lives don't have to be Pinterest perfect. Our kids are just as nourished by peanut butter sandwiches or a random casserole made out of leftovers from the fridge as they are by a gourmet meal. And as for those kids, if they're alive at the end of the day, you've done great. That's a win. If they're alive, it doesn't matter if they got too much screen time. It doesn't matter if the house is a mess. You know, keep the bar at a reasonable place. Are you getting through the day without collapsing? That's a win. That's the bar. That's the bar. Just get through the day without collapsing or losing track of who you really are. You know, we have plenty of time to figure out how to do this. So please give yourselves all the grace in the world. I think sometimes that maintaining artificially high standards for ourselves is an act of violence. People call it shoulding all over ourselves, right? I should, I should, I should. Nope. It's violence. Pretending everything is okay, projecting that illusion of eternal optimism is an act of violence as well, in that it keeps others who desperately need to feel, have permission to confess that they're not okay, keeps them from feeling seen and cared for. I think we need to get comfortable winging it, making stuff up, repurposing, experimenting, failing. There was a time when I was a brand new, newly minted minister, when I had this horrible week. I had 5 new cancer diagnoses and like 6 people coming in with stories of abuse and mental illness. And I just got so overwhelmed. And I went for a walk and just kind of tried to hold it all. And when I came back, I knew what to do. And what I did was I had this bowl of little polished rocks, and I would pick up the rock and let that rock represent one of the people that I would, one of the stories that I was having a hard time holding, one of the people that I was worried about. And I just hold it in my hand and surround it with sort of love and warmth. And then, this was the important part, I would set it down on a beautiful tray, and I would just line up the stones and line up the stones. Now, that's how I got through it. And I knew what I needed to do to get through it. And all of us have that capacity, that inner wise person who can tell us that this is what will help. So we need to trust that inner MacGyver, that subconscious, brilliant, wise self. I don't believe that bad things happen for a reason, or that the universe sends us particular lessons or punishes us. You're allowed to believe things, I don't, but for me, it just doesn't jibe with my experience of life. But what I don't believe that there's a grand plan behind these bad things that happen, but I do believe that humans have an almost limitless capacity to adapt, and not just adapt, but learn and grow in response to all of life, but especially in response to the hard things, the bad things. Above all, please remember this. The only way we're going to get through this is if we stick together, offering one another spiritual duct tape and chewing gum in those moments. And we all have moments in those moments when it feels like our hearts and our lives are falling apart. We need one another always, but we need one another now more than ever. I love you. So be it, and so may it be. This is a poem called Some Assembly Required. Building a life is a little like building a car out of a mountain of spare parts. Random, jumbled, overwhelming, each piece must be cleaned and polished, correctly identified, properly stored, so you can find what you need when you're far enough along to know. Some people inherit and need only make repairs. Others get a pile of junk or a dishwasher or nothing at all. No one gets an instruction manual. So many hours spent contemplating, does this go here? Does that belong there? Until finally the call of the road drowns out our doubts, leads us to look up from our work, lay down our tools, and walk into the forest, shedding spark plugs and cylinders as we go. Let's join together in singing our sung benediction, There is a Love Holding Me.